Hello, everyone, and welcome to Hockey Night in Canada Online. I'm your host, Rob Pizzo, alongside Mike Brophy. And Mike, we had two games last night, two coming up tonight, and more award finalists named. So let's get right to it. But first, we want to let you know how you can get in contact with us. We do this each and every day because we want to hear from you. Send us a tweet. Send us a message on Facebook. Let us know something you want to talk about, a question you may have, or just, you know, say we're two good guys. They can compliment us as well, bro.
But let's accurate.
That would, well, we haven't got one of those yet, so I'm not too sure. Let's get to last night's games because we had two, and they were two very big games, and I'm very proud to report, bro, that all is right in the world again. Oh. Sidney Crosby finally breaking the goose egg. And I was sitting on my couch and you can almost hear the sigh of relief coming from Sid because he got a lot of chances in game number two. Finally buries it in game number three. Pittsburgh with a 2-0 lead. We'll talk about another guy who had a big part in this win in just a second. But they've now got a 2-1 lead in their series. And Marian Gaborik at it again. That's his league-leading sixth goal of the playoffs. This is a big surprise to me. The LA Kings take both games in Anaheim. They get to return home with a 2-0 series lead. But let's go back to that Pittsburgh game. We know Crosby can score, but the big question mark has always been Marc-André Fleury. Back-to-back shutouts for Fleury. I mean, we're all over him when he doesn't do well. We've got to give him credit when he does actually play well.
Absolutely, and he's looked very solid in getting these shutouts. It wasn't a case of Marc-André Fleury was lucky. He's just looked so good. Now, the problem is we could be standing here 1 week from today saying, how did the Penguins lose the next two games, and why did Marc-André Fleury let in 11 goals? So, I mean, inconsistency has been a problem throughout his career, but I will say, giving credit where credit is due, over the last couple of games, he's played as well as we've ever seen him. And if he continues to play this way, all of a sudden the Pittsburgh Penguins, in my view, move up a couple notches in terms of being a true Stanley Cup contender. Because right now I see, you know, the Boston Bruins, LA Kings, and Chicago Blackhawks as being in one group and everybody else being in another group.
And you look at just some of the shots he faced last night. These were not shots from the outside without a screen. He had some traffic in front of him, and he just seemed calm. I still think his rebound control is still needs a little bit of work. There were quite a few times where he kicked it right back into the danger zone in on the ice. But you can really not argue about back-to-back shutouts for a guy who's been told. And this is all coming after, you know, the blunder against Columbus where he went behind the net. And that's all I kept thinking last night at the end of the game. Just stay in that blue paint, Marc-André. Just stay there. Do not do anything that can get you into trouble and give Brof and I something to talk about tomorrow. But let's stick with this series because we've got a very legitimate question. It's a topic a lot of people are discussing. Is it fair that these teams play back-to-back? That's from Cater Waller on Twitter. Not only back-to-back, the New York Rangers have played five games in seven nights. Your thoughts on this?
It's not about being fair. I mean, at the end of the day, the Pittsburgh Penguins in the first round played six games. If they had been like the Habs and won four straight, they would have had a rest. The New York Rangers went to seven games, missed an opportunity to close the series out. It's all about arena availability. The only problem I have with these things is, and I feel bad for the fans, because last night, did we see two teams playing at the very top level in NHL playoff hockey? And I would hearken to say, no, we probably didn't, because they have to conserve a bit of energy. So it's difficult on the players. It's difficult on everybody involved. But at the end of the day, it's not about being fair, simply about arena availability. It's too bad.
And not only that, am I the only heartless guy that looks at the New York Rangers and said, looks at it, their schedule and thinks, if you would have beat Philadelphia in game number six, you would have had some rest. Sometimes in the playoffs, you dig your own hole. They could have finished that series off in six. They lose game six, have to play game seven, and then turn around to start their series against the Pittsburgh Penguins. So it's not as though they swept a series and then unfortunately had to play 2 days later.
And then, of course, if you get time off, then everybody says, oh, you were playing well, you're on a roll, you want to keep going. So there's no pleasing everybody.
And Alain Vigneault kind of made me laugh. Before that game, he was asked about the rest and the rust and everything else, and he said, well, Henrik Lundqvist has played every single minute in the playoffs. If he's not complaining, we don't have a right to complain. After last night's game, well, I'm proud of my guys after this stupid schedule is what he said. So kind of playing both angles there. But I agree with you wholeheartedly. Last night's game, and I sent this out on Twitter, kind of felt like a mid-December
game. It really did.
Just did not have that playoff feel, that atmosphere, especially when you watch the LA game right after, where you've got two teams that genuinely don't like each other and are really playing hard. The emotions seem to be missing.
Yeah, that's the point I'm making. Like, you've got these guys who just, to me, aren't going at 100%, or maybe they're just unable to go at 100% because of the fatigue factor. And I know people will say fatigue is a mental thing, but I disagree. It's every bit as much physical as it is mental, and it's just too much to ask these guys. The Rangers in particular, 5 games and 7 nights in the playoffs, man, that's old school.
And you can't tell me that fatigue hasn't had something to do with their power play. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm getting tired of watching that power play.
It is ugly.
It really is.
They have to get back to basics here and just get some shots on net. Don't make as many passes as they're trying. They're almost trying to get too cute because they realize something's wrong with that power play. Let's go back to Sid the Kid, because obviously when he does something, people want to talk about it. Joe Dreds wants to know, why does everyone care so much about Crosby scoring?
A very simple answer to that is because he's the best player in the world, and we're just not used to seeing Sidney Crosby go 13 games in a row without a goal. And what made it even worse, and I think most people would agree, is that throughout most of that slump that Sidney was in, he did not look like the prototypical Sidney Crosby. He didn't have the fight to his game. Now, in the last 2 games, including the game he didn't score in, he's looked very much like vintage Sidney Crosby. But, you know, this is no different than, let's say, Tiger Woods is in a slump. Everybody would be talking about it. If a home run hitter goes 20 games without a home run, we talk about it. A field goal kicker misses 4 in a row, we're talking about it. When you're one of the best in a league, then, and you're in a slump, hey, it's natural that everybody's going to talk about
it. And you know the ratio we talk about when it comes to suspensions? Basically, one playoff game is like 2 regular season games. I think the same thing comes into play when you're talking about a slump. If you don't score in the playoffs, that's like not scoring for 2 games in the regular season, especially when you're the best player on the planet. Now, I mentioned this game kind of had a lull to it. It really didn't seem like a playoff game. LA and Anaheim last night was pretty much the opposite. We've got a question coming in from Stephen Larry. Ducks, what are you doing? Can't let the Kings get ahead like this. Not really a question, but more of a comment.
Well,
your thoughts.
You know, I get Steve Larry's point. It's disheartening to lose a couple games at home, but let's take a look at the stats. They outshot the Kings 37-17. They outhit them 53-42. They won 33 faceoffs and lost 28. They only took 8 penalty minutes compared to 10. Their power play was 1-for-4 compared to the Kings 0-for-3. So statistically, they absolutely dominated the hockey game. That is what they're going to hang their hat on. Plus the fact that in the regular season, they won a couple of road games in LA. Hey, they're up against what we have called a machine. The LA Kings are playing unbelievable hockey. Marian Gaborik is simply lighting it up and has done so since he was acquired in the trade from the Columbus Blue Jackets. I know it's frustrating when your favorite team loses a couple of games, especially when it's at home, but boy, oh boy, when you look at the numbers, I don't think the Kings are that far out of it.
Kopitar as well has been an absolute beast. And Jonathan Quick has, you know, realized after game number 3 of that first round that he is, in fact, Jonathan Quick. He has played great. Let's move on to a question about coaches, because we've got 5 coaching vacancies right now, possibly 2 more to come. And Holly H. says, so many coaches have been fired. Where are they all winding up? So where's your crystal ball, bro?
Yeah, really. I mean, I don't know where they're all going to end up. I would say of the 5 that were fired, the guy who's most in demand is this guy, Barry Trotz. He just is such a sound defensive coach in an era where the emphasis is on defensive hockey. Most people would concede that he did a pretty good job with the Nashville Predators, although his playoff record leaves a little be desired. John Tortorella, in my mind right now, I said it before, I'll say it again, he's a real hot potato. Just too much drama with him. And then you've got Kirk Muller, Adam Oates, and Peter Horacek, the other guys. I think those 3 guys would be candidates to wind up on a coaching staff as an assistant. I think all 3 of them are good hockey men. They bring something to the table. Whether or not they'll get a chance to be a head coach after losing their jobs that they just lost, they may one day, but I would say probably the next step for them is to become an NHL assistant coach and stay in the coaching game.
Peter Laviolette's name's got to be thrown into that as well. You know, a lot of coaches, or a lot of teams, excuse me, would love to see him behind their bench. Let's get you set up for tonight. Habs and Bruins, game number 3 after what a heartbreaking loss for the Montreal Canadiens in game number 2 on Saturday. Please tell me the Habs will win the cup. They're the best. Mohamed Sharon, again, not really a question, but more of a comment. But we ask for questions, comments, anything people want to say. But, you know, I'm more wondering if they can bounce back from that game, because they could have escaped Beantown up 2 games nothing. They blow a 3-1 lead in the 3rd period. That's got to be heartbreaking.
Well, I can't tell Mohamed the Habs are going to win the cup definitively, because I still think they're long shots. if you said going into the series that you're going to go to Boston and come back with a split, you would be happy with that if you're a Montreal Canadian. What you're not happy with is the fact that you imploded in the third period and you let the Boston Bruins come back to beat you. I think it becomes a bit of a mind game now. You have to convince yourself, if you're a member of the Montreal Canadiens, that it was more about you letting down in the third period than the Boston Bruins flexing their muscles and showing you what a great team they are. And then now you take it home to Montreal, where you've got the most amazing fans in hockey. It's a great atmosphere. And you've got Carey Price. And the great thing about that is, of all the goalies in the NHL, is there anybody like Carey Price who shrugs off a defeat like he does? I mean, hey, he feels it. He's like anybody else. He feels the loss, but he's also able to put it in perspective that it's history. There's nothing he can do about it. And he knows he's got a big challenge facing him. You know, the Boston Bruins are such an amazing team. But I like his calmness. And I think if you've got a goalie who's got that calm demeanor, it spreads the calmness throughout the dressing room.
And you look at Carey Price, something like what happened the other day. He lost his two dogs. And he just, it's happened before. It'll happen again. I found them. You're right. He kind of has that ability to shrug everything off. And if you're the goaltender for the Montreal Canadiens, you have to be able to do that.
Yes.
The other game tonight, Game 3, Chicago and Minnesota. Blackhawks did what the Blackhawks are supposed to do, won their two games in the Windy City, and now they're heading to Minnesota. I think if there's going to be a game that Minnesota wins, it's this one, but I still see really two teams that are on different levels.
Well, I mean, take a look at the star players on the hockey teams. The Minnesota Wild, the Chicago Blackhawks star players, Brian Bickle, and I call him a star because he's a playoff star with five goals, and this is the way it's been for a couple of years. The guys that you expect to play well are playing well for the Chicago Blackhawks, and they... It's the oldest saying in the world, your best players have to be your best players. And you look at the Minnesota players, their guys are struggling. Zach Parise, one assist in the last three games. Hey, he's got 11 points in the playoffs, that's great, but it's a what have you done for me lately league. And then Ryan Suter, no points in the last three games. So their star players going home have to be their stars.
Absolutely. All right, before we go, we've done this every show. We get three new candidates for some NHL hardware. I'm sure if you watch the show on a regular basis, you know this is coming. The Jack Adams Award.